Hey guys, I apologize that I have not been on YouTube for, I think it's been almost a month. So anyway, this is actually a speech that I give sometimes, but I wanted to consolidate it and give you a packed version of what I give in a regular speech because it's so important and it's very valuable information. We really need to change the conversation that we have about the Constitution. So the name of this speech or this presentation is Why We Shouldn't Need the Bill of Rights. Which probably sounds a little kind of scary to a lot of people, like, well, of course we need the Bill of Rights, right? And I understand, because we hold the Bill of Rights in high regard, right? And we think of the Bill of Rights as sort of one of the most important things in the American government. And it is very important, and I would not downplay that. And of course, that's the reason I say we shouldn't, because we obviously do need the Bill of Rights, sort of the implication of shouldn't rather than don't need the Bill of Rights. If I said we don't need the Bill of Rights, that would be one thing, but I'm saying we shouldn't need the Bill of Rights. So I'm gonna just start out by saying we don't have rights in the United States. We have something called liberty, okay? And there's a really big difference between rights and liberty. And I think that a lot of Americans conflate the two. I mean, there's a big difference. And you'll see as we go through this what I mean by that, because that probably sounds confusing. But understand that the Bill of Rights is an amendment to the Constitution. And I've noticed that a lot of people, when they talk about the Constitution, they're referring to the Bill of Rights. In other words, they don't talk about the Constitution and mean the actual Constitution. Usually when somebody talks about the Constitution, they mean the Bill of Rights. And that's not the Constitution. Yes, it is a part of the Constitution now. All of the amendments technically are, but they're not the original document, the one that was ratified in 1789, right? And if that document was being followed, we wouldn't need the Bill of Rights. So I just gave you the end right there, but I will explain this a little further. So what I would suggest you do is go watch my video. I can put a link here. Watch my video on the powers that Congress has. So what is Congress allowed to make laws about? These are called enumerated powers. Okay, this is in Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution. These powers are the only powers about which Congress can make law, and they're very limited. There's no education, healthcare, welfare, social security, marriage, law, in the sense of police crime law. There's no crime law in there. There's a ton of stuff that we're accustomed to the federal government making laws about missing. There is no constitutional, what's the word, justification for the federal government making all of these laws. Now, I could get into a whole discussion about how the courts have changed and reinterpreted and misinterpreted and all of that to allow for the federal government to do a lot of the things that they're doing now. But we're just going to keep it simple. The federal government can only make laws about the very specific things listed, the very specific topics listed in Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution. I'll flash up those things right here, right now, if you want to look at them. These are the topics. You'll notice some simple things like taxation, declaring war, creating the Army and the Navy, post offices. That's really it, though. These are the only things that Congress can make laws about. They're called enumerated powers. They're delegated to the legislature, and the legislature can only make laws about those specific topics. Okay. Now, the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists in the founding era disagreed about whether or not there should be a Bill of Rights. So the Constitution was ratified in 1789, and the Bill of Rights came around in those, like, in the 1790, 1791. So why would one group of the founding fathers not want the Bill of Rights? That seems like a sort of odd thing to be opposed to. It seems like we should want a Bill of Rights, a list of the rights that we want protected, right? Well, let me give you a quote by James Madison, and he was a Federalist, okay? So he supported the Constitution, he supported a larger federal government, and he was not really for the Bill of Rights at the initial signing of the Constitution. The Anti-Federalists, on the other hand, did not like the government, hence the anti-federal government, Anti-Federalists, and they were really, really adamant that there should be a Bill of Rights. So Madison explains the way that the Constitution was created. He says, the powers of the federal government are enumerated, which is what I just said, enumerated powers. It can only operate in certain cases. It has legislative powers on defined and limited objects, beyond which it cannot extend its jurisdiction. So anything beyond these objects that it can make laws about, it cannot do. Congress cannot make laws about anything other than these specific topics. So I'm going to read you a quote by a man named Dr. Lawson. I'll put a link down here to his articles about this sort of idea of the Bill of Rights and the limited government, because I think what he says is fantastic. But I want to read it to you, and I'll put the quote up here. He writes on the Constitution Center, and he's a professor, I believe, at Boston University. And he writes this, so just read along with me. In sum, the Constitution's framers thought that a Bill of Rights was appropriate for an unlimited government. Okay, so you would need a Bill of Rights for an unlimited government, but not for a limited one like the national government created by the Constitution. The Constitution accordingly sought to secure liberty, not rights, but liberty, through enumerations of powers to the government rather than through enumerations of rights to the people. It remains a government of limited and enumerated powers, so that the first question involving an exercise of federal power is not whether it violates someone's rights, but whether it exceeds the national government's enumerated powers. This is a beautiful quote. So first of all, you could go one of two ways. You could make a government that lists out all of the rights that the people have that the government must protect and cannot violate. Or you can do what they did and create a very limited government where they don't need to list out every single right, because if that government's limited, those rights are not going to be violated in the first place. Okay? So you really need to have a list of rights that government can't violate if your government's unlimited. So then you have to sort of limit what it can do by saying you can't violate these very specific things. The problem with that method is that you're probably going to miss something, right? Rights can be enumerable because rights are inexplicably attached to liberty, and liberty is undefinable, right? Liberty is liberty. And so liberty is by default going to be violated by an unlimited government that is only confined to not violating a specific set of rights. They're going to find a way to violate something that's not mentioned in that set of rights. So the founders weren't interested in that. They wanted to protect liberty, and they wanted a very limited government, okay? So Hamilton, Alexander Hamilton, who was also a Federalist, he brought up sort of one of the key arguments against the Bill of Rights. And he said, the Bill of Rights would contain various exceptions to powers not granted, and on this very account would afford a colorable pretext to claim more than were granted. For why declare that things shall not be done, which there is no power to do? In other words, since the Constitution confines the federal government's power to a very select, very limited set of powers, and there's no way with that limited set of powers that they can violate any of the rights mentioned in the Bill of Rights, not to mention any not mentioned in the Bill of Rights, because just in case you didn't know, we have more than 10 rights. Why tell the government that it can't do something that it already can't do? Let that settle in for a second. Why do you list out to the federal government that it can't violate your free speech if it is not allowed to violate your free speech, right? There's absolutely nothing in that Article 1, Section 8 list of enumerated powers that gives the federal government any power whatsoever to make laws that would violate your free speech, your guns, or anything else mentioned in those Bill of Rights. So by telling the federal government it can't violate these specific rights that it already can't violate, it actually opens the door to the possibility that it could violate the Constitution, thereby putting some of these rights in jeopardy. It's much easier for me to do this in person so I can sort of gauge how well this is sinking into my audience, because this is something that a lot of people, it's sort of a foreign concept to us. We don't really think about the fact that our federal government, should it stay confined, if it stayed within the limit of the Constitution, and I mean the first written Constitution, if it stayed within those limits, we wouldn't need the Bill of Rights, because the federal government would never and could never write a law that would ever violate a single one of those Bill of Rights. So let me read you this. This is also by Dr. Lawson. He says, the Bill of Rights were considered unnecessary because the national government was a limited government that could only exercise those powers granted to it by the Constitution, and it had been granted no power to violate the most cherished rights of the people, right? So by making a list of rights that the government could not infringe upon, it diminished the power of the Constitution's enumerated powers by insinuating that the government could potentially pass laws about issues they had no power to pass laws about. Also, now the amendments can be used to justify unconstitutional behavior by simply stating that the unconstitutional behavior is not violating any of the 10 amendments. Since most American citizens don't actually know the actual Constitution and only know the Bill of Rights, that means that the federal government is pretty capable of violating our rights and our liberty all the time and violating the Constitution as long as they don't violate those 10 rights. rights, right? So they may violate our right to choose our own healthcare, but that's not one of the 10 rights listed in the Bill of Rights. So nobody pays attention to the fact that there's nowhere in the Constitution that gives the federal government any right to create laws about healthcare. I could go on and on and on in this list. But here's the thing about the Bill of Rights. They are essentially a failsafe to the Constitution. If the federal government chooses to act outside of the powers enumerated to it, then the amendments begin to play a bigger role. Remember, the federal government derives its power from the Constitution. Okay, the Constitution is basically a job description for the federal government. If the federal government does things outside of the Constitution, if it just has inherent power, then the power in the federal government would be what we'd call arbitrary power or unconfined. The founders wanted to avoid this. The Constitution exists to limit the powers of the government by clearly defining exactly what the federal government can do or its sphere of power. The government only has power because of the Constitution. So here's another quote by Dr. Lawson. Go read his whole write-up on this. Nonetheless, the Supreme Court, especially in the late 19th century and early 20th century, has sometimes been very fond of arguments that run something like this. All self-respecting governments can do X. Our national government is a self-respecting government, therefore our national government can do X. This kind of reasoning was used to support dubious federal powers to exercise eminent domain, to implement a military draft, to hold overseas colonies, and to pass laws concerning immigration. In other words, the Supreme Court has begun interpreting the Constitution, or more or less throwing out the Constitution, and saying that the federal government's power is not derived from the Constitution, but rather the federal government's power is derived from itself, its inherent power. It has power simply because it is. And that type of power is exactly the type of power that the founders wanted to avoid, because that type of power is unconfined and unlimited. You cannot limit something that has no limits, right? If government has power simply because it has power, who defines what power that is? There is no limit to that. It's the same as if a king has power simply because he's king. You can't tell the king that he can't behead someone simply because you want to tell him he can't. There's nothing you can say. If he believes that someone should be beheaded, it's his prerogative as king to do so. That is what is so dangerous about this type of arbitrary power. And I think this sort of puts everything into context. Dr. Lawson says, the 10th Amendment, along with the rest of the Bill of Rights, might have value as a kind of backstop in the case the original Constitution's meaning gets too deranged. In modern times, the enumerated powers of the national government have been misread beyond all recognition, to the point that the actual Constitution is not really a part of the governing structure at all. We live with a shadow or zombie Constitution that has the outer husk of the original document, but none of the actual substance. Once the enumerated powers have been misconstrued out of existence, weight falls on the rest of the Constitution, most notably the Bill of Rights, to restore to some very modest degree the original balance of power. So basically, every amendment acts as a fail-safe for an unlimited government, okay? When government's power is unlimited, specific dictates about what rights it cannot infringe upon really do come in handy. The unfortunate thing is, today we talk about the Bill of Rights as if they are the Constitution, as if they are what protects liberty. But friends, the point of this talk is to tell you that the Bill of Rights protects 10 rights. The Constitution protects liberty, right? What we need is to reestablish the preeminence of the Constitution. And if we did that, we would never have concern about the Bill of Rights. In fact, all of the debates about what free speech is or means, all of the debates about gun rights and what does it mean to have a militia, etc., so on and so forth, are vain. Because there's nowhere in the Constitution that gives the federal government any right to make laws about any of these topics in the first place. So it really wouldn't matter what these amendments meant or didn't mean, because Congress can't make laws about them anyway. You see, when we want to protect the Constitution, we should protect the Constitution. If we protect the Constitution, the Bill of Rights will be safe. If we need the Bill of Rights, we know we're long gone. If we've made it to the point that government is threatening to violate those specific 10 rights, then we know they violated many more before they ever made it to these. Because this means the federal government has far exceeded its enumerated powers and is violating rights left and right, and destroying liberty all around. Reestablishing the preeminence of the Constitution would change all of that. That is my goal. So I want to end with this quote by Alexander Hamilton. And this is a long quote, so just bear with me here. There is no position which depends on clearer principles than that every act of delegated authority, contrary to the tenor of the commission under which it is exercised, is void. And that sounds fancy, but this will make more sense. He says, no legislative act, therefore, contrary to the Constitution, can be valid. Can't be more straightforward than that. So friends, I hope this makes sense, and I hope that you take this and really kind of make it a part of you, make it a part of what you discuss and debate. So when you hear people talking about the Constitution, ask them what they mean. How many times are you going to find that most people mean the Bill of Rights? And then draw them back to the realization that if the federal government was following the Constitution in the first place, we wouldn't even need those Bill of Rights because the federal government could never even begin to violate something like our free speech or our guns or our right to a trial. All of these things are not allowed to be touched if the federal government follows the Constitution. We give them the right to violate the Constitution by only focusing on the Bill of Rights, because then we don't pay attention to all the ways they violate our liberty by overstepping their enumerated powers in various ways, because at least the First Amendment hasn't been violated. Well, friends, I can guarantee you this First Amendment will eventually be violated if they are willing to violate the actual document itself of the Constitution. So go read that Article 1, Section 8, or watch my video to learn more about what those enumerated powers are if you haven't done that before. Go read Dr. Lawson's write-up on this 10th Amendment in the Constitution Center. I'll put the link down here. I just read a lot of his quotes, but go read it for yourself. It's fascinating. It will really open your eyes to the kind of misunderstanding that most American citizens have about the Bill of Rights and the Constitution and the way that all of our government was supposed to operate in the first place. Well, I hope that this was informative and educational for you guys. If you want to learn more, I have written articles about this topic, but I thought a video might also be helpful. So you can go to my website. I put it down here. It's www.thelibertybellnc.com. So go check that out and leave comments. I'd like to hear your comments. I'd like to hear your thoughts. And I will see you next time.